Mr. Robot easily ranks as one of my favorite TV shows of all time. In addition to the realistic hacking scenes it portrays, the show truly delivers on multiple fronts. That's why I came up with the idea of making this video, where I'll be breaking down multiple hacking scenes from the show, and explain whether or not such attacks are possible in the real world, so let's get started.
Disclaimer.
This video is intended for cybersecurity enthusiasts and is for educational or entertainment purposes only. Black hat hacking is highly discouraged and can result in serious legal consequences.
Hack number 1, breaking a drug dealer out of jail.
Okay, so starting with the most famous hack from season 1 episode 6 of the show, Elliot, who is a cybersecurity specialist by day, and a black hat hacker by night, is being blackmailed by a ruthless drug dealer named Wera, to hack him out of prison before midnight. Elliot tries to explain to Wera that such an attack can't be done in a matter of hours, but rather days or weeks are needed in order for him to find a security vulnerability that he can exploit, but Wera being Wera, does not give Elliot more time, and he now has to employ some non-ideal techniques for hacking the drug dealer out of jail. So the first thing he tries to do is rely on his hacker friend Darlene, to drop some infected flash drives outside the prison facility, and socially engineer someone within the jail's network to pick one up and insert it into their computer, as that would establish a reverse shell on their system, and give Elliot the opportunity to execute commands remotely, escalate his privileges, and gain a deeper access into the prison's network. However, just as an officer picks up one of the infected USB drives and inserts it into his computer, the antivirus software detects it, and disconnects Elliot out of the system. As a result, Elliot lectures Darlene and calls her a script kiddie for using a well-known malware from Rapid9, which was a reference to Metasploit's developer Rapid7, instead of developing a new exploit, and Darlene defends herself saying,
"I had an hour."
So was this hacking scene logically constructed, and could this approach have been effective in the real world if the malware managed to slip through the antivirus system undetected? Well, yes, but only because the malware was disguised as something desirable to click, and relied on social engineering tactics that many people still fall for today. Also, looking back at the scene, I think if Darlene had used more advanced techniques like fileless malware or obfuscating the payload using a cryptor, she could have potentially breached the system undetected. And if you're not sure about what that means or the different methods hackers use to gain access to a system, you can watch this video by clicking on the I button above. Anyways, coming back to the hack, after failing in his first attempt, Elliot visits Wera in jail, and brings his phone with him to scan for a vulnerable access point that he can exploit. However, he quickly discovers that all the APs are secured with WPA2, and the limited time frame he is working with isn't sufficient for brute forcing them. But just as he was leaving the facility discouraged, Elliot spots a Bluetooth connection when a cop's car parks near him. Upon a closer look, he notices that the Bluetooth connection is linked to a keyboard connected to the cop's laptop inside the car. This sparks a new strategy in his mind, performing a Bluetooth impersonation attack, where he would be spoofing his own keyboard to mimic the cop's keyboard, and tricking the cop's laptop into thinking it's connected to the legitimate keyboard. This approach would allow him to control the cop's laptop through his keyboard and gain access to the prison's network, from where he could upload his malware and assume control over the facility's digitally controlled system. So to achieve this, Darlene first approaches the cop car to distract the officer from his laptop, and Elliot then plugs in his Bluetooth adapter to start scanning for nearby devices using the HCI tool, a built-in tool for Bluetooth configuration in Kali Linux. Once he discovers the cop's Bluetooth connection through HCI, he retrieves the MAC address and ID of the Bluetooth device to clone his own keyboard with this information. Finally, he proceeds to use the cop's computer with his cloned keyboard and uploads his malware via FTP. This malware would grant him control over the prison cell doors, and enable him to hack Wera out of prison. So was this hack logical? Well, yes, but only with a few technical flaws. Firstly, in order for Elliot to successfully impersonate the cop's keyboard, he would also need something called a link key, which is generated and stored when two Bluetooth devices pair for the first time, and without it, he couldn't just rely on the MAC address and device ID to impersonate the cop's keyboard. Also, even if we assume that Elliot somehow forced a re-pairing process to capture the link keys using a tool like Ubertooth 1, he would still need to jam the existing Bluetooth connection before his spoof device could take over, since Bluetooth devices don't allow multiple connections at the same time. However, I still vouch for this scene as everything else was quite accurate and presented very creatively. If you're interested in learning more about Bluetooth hacking and the different attack vectors used by hackers, you can watch this video by clicking on the I button above.
Hack number 2, hijacking FBI phone calls to eavesdrop on their communications.
Okay, so now that we've explored a prison hacking scene from the show, let's take a look at another one from season 2 episode 6 of the series, where Elliot, with the help of his hacking group called F Society, managed to take down one of the world's largest tech conglomerates called E Corp, and led to the collapse of the global economy. As a result, the FBI got involved and initiated an intense investigation to uncover the individuals behind this hack, starting their search from within the E-Corp headquarters. In response to this threat, Elliot needed to come up with a way to hack the cell phone of every FBI agent involved in this investigation and eavesdrop on their communications to anticipate their next move. With the help of his friends at F Society, he quickly developed a brilliant plan and was now ready to put it into action.
Step number one, femtocells.
Now, in order for you to understand what Elliot's plan was and how it was executed, you first need to know what a femtocell is, as the whole plan was dependent on this one device. A femtocell is basically a small cell phone tower that is designed for individuals who experience poor cell phone signals in their homes or offices. It helps by compelling all nearby cell phones to connect to it and rerouting their signals through the internet. These devices are sold by multiple cell phone carriers, and you can find most of them on Amazon for about $120 to $200. But how did Elliot manage to utilize this seemingly innocent and legal device to hack the cell phone of every FBI agent involved in the investigation? Well, he planned to modify this device according to his needs by updating its firmware using OpenWRT. OpenWRT is a real-life open-source project that allows developers to download and edit firmware for various routers and other devices in order to enhance their functionality. Elliot or other members at F Society must have downloaded a firmware from OpenWRT and modified it so that it would intercept all the phone calls in the area and send the data to the attackers before forwarding it to the original carrier. This allowed them to effectively convert a femtocell into a malicious cell phone tower. Now, a femtocell typically extends up to about 10 meters in range, meaning that Elliot would need to place this femtocell both inside the E-Corp's building and on the same floor as the FBI agents who were investigating the hack. So how would he do this with all the physical security inside the building? Well, this is where his childhood friend and an E-Corp employee named Angela comes into play. Angela, who had access to the building, sneaks to the floor where the FBI was investigating undetected, and manages to place the femtocell within one of the cubicles, connecting the femtocell to the internet using a yellow Ethernet cable that can be seen in the frame. Once the femtocell was in place, all the cell phone calls within the area were routed through this modified device, and F Society with their back door could then divert and record all the calls to a remote location. So was this hack logical? Well, yes, but only if the femtocell that F Society was using had a chipset that OpenWRT could run on, and also if they executed a downgrade attack to force the FBI phones into using a weaker connection, as modern cellular networks use strong encryption and require the data to be decrypted even if the calls are intercepted. Also, keep in mind that executing such an attack in real life would require extensive knowledge, and a hacker might encounter numerous complexities that weren't depicted in the show. Speaking of requiring extensive knowledge, before we dive into the next hack, where we'll explore how hackers exploit cars using a laptop and a diagnostic port called the OBD2 port, I'd like to thank the sponsor of this video, Brilliant.org. It's pretty clear by now that problem solving is what allowed Elliot to pull off all of his attacks, and in reality, that same critical thinking is what separates an average hacker from an expert. Brilliant.org is exactly the platform for building that kind of skill set, with thousands of interactive lessons in foundational math, programming, science, data analysis, and AI. Unlike traditional learning methods, it keeps you engaged with hands-on activities, which has proven to be 6 times more effective than simply watching lectures, and since all of its content is crafted by experts from places like Stanford, MIT, or Google, you know you're learning from the best. I've personally found their app to be a game-changer, as instead of mindlessly scrolling on your phone, you could be learning Python by spending just a few minutes per day, and sharpening your problem-solving skills along the way. To try everything Brilliant has to offer free for a full 30 days, just visit brilliant.org/AnnonAlley, or scan the QR code on screen, and get an exclusive 20% discount on Brilliant's annual premium subscription. Thanks for listening, let's get back to the video.
Hack number 3, stealing a car using its controller area network.
Okay, so the final attack we're gonna be looking at comes from Season 4, Episode 4 of the series, where Darlene, after attempting to contact Elliot numerous times, felt that something was wrong, and decided to visit his apartment. Upon arriving, she found a strange note saying,
"They're listening,"
and unexpectedly received a text message from her brother containing a remote location without any context. This location appeared to be somewhere deep within the woods, and in order to get there, she needed transportation. Given that it was Christmas night, and finding a taxi was unlikely, she decided to hack a car and steal it. Now, typically when a hacker attempts to hack a car in order to steal it, their first step is to get the car doors unlocked and gain access inside the car. There are several methods of doing this, but the most basic ones involve performing a replay attack or a jamming attack on a car with a keyless entry system. In a replay attack, a hacker positions themselves near the targeted vehicle and waits for the owner to use their key fob in order to unlock it. When the owner presses the button, the hacker captures the unlocking signals transmitted between the car's door and the key fob using a device like HackRF1, and once the owner leaves the area, they then transmit the same signals to unlock the car. In a jamming attack, the hacker focuses on blocking or disrupting communication between the car and the key fob using a signal jammer, causing the car to remain unlocked, while making the owner believe it to be securely locked. If you're interested in learning more about radio hacking and the limitations that come with these attacks, you can check out this video by clicking on the I button above, but for now, just know that as Darlene was in a hurry, and couldn't wait to perform either of these conventional attacks, she found a slightly older car from the early 2000s that had a manual locking system, and used a specially crafted copper wire with a hook to pull up the door's lock and unlock it.
Step number 2, connecting to the controller area network.
Once the car's door was unlocked and she was inside, we can then see her turning on her laptop running Kali Linux, a Linux distribution specifically designed for hackers, and connecting her laptop to the car's diagnostic system using a port under the dashboard called the OBD2 port. These ports are built into nearly every vehicle, and are used by car mechanics or technicians to access the car's controller area network or CAN, and identify potential issues with the car's engine or other components. A hacker can connect their device to this port using an inexpensive adapter such as this one, and inject certain commands or do things like cluster manipulation, by installing a software called CANutilis on their laptop. CANutilis is basically an open source project for Linux, that contains various utilities for allowing a computer to communicate with the controller area network of a car. We can also see Darlene running a utility called CANSniffer from the same CANutilis software in the next scene. However, before she could proceed with the attack, she was interrupted by the car's owner and failed, but even if she hadn't been interrupted, this part of the hack didn't make much sense. That's because car hacking isn't as simple as walking up to any car and plugging in your laptop to start it. Since different car models have unique CAN protocols, a hacker must first obtain a car of the same make and model that they're trying to hack, connect their laptop to study how it communicates, and then when they get the chance to exploit it, they simply inject the pre-captured packets into the car rather than trying to do it on the spot. So if Darlene had already done her research before hacking this car, she wouldn't have needed CANSniffer at this stage. Instead, she would have simply used another utility called CANSend to inject the correct ignition packets, since sniffing for packets when the car is turned off isn't possible. However, I still vouch for this scene as it was far more accurate than 90% of Hollywood's depiction of hacking, and showcased real tools and methodologies even if the execution wasn't entirely realistic. Anyway guys, so that's it for the video. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the comments section down below, and I'll see you in the next one.